No matter what activity you are doing with a child with high muscle tone, the keys to success are controlling the environment, using the right handling techniques, and taking care with how you position the child. Everyone's muscles get more tense in certain situations, when we are afraid or cold, for example. Children with high muscle tone are no different. You are a part of the child's environment. The way you talk and move will affect how relaxed the child is. If you do not know the child well, tell him or her who you are and what you're going to do in a calm, friendly, not too loud voice. You want everything about the environment to be as relaxing as possible. Pay attention to your surroundings. If there's a lot of noise out in the hallway, shut the door. Is there a bright light shining in the child's eyes? Move it or turn it off or pull the curtains. Turn the TV off. This will help you and the child focus. Including the child's attention in what you are doing makes it less likely that you will startle him or her, triggering high muscle tone. Take one more look around the room. Is there anything else that may be distracting, distressing, or exciting to the child? Finally, make sure the child is warm enough, as everyone's muscles get more tense when they are cold. If you plan to start an IV, draw blood, or make a cast or splint, be sure to wrap the part of the body you'll be working with in a warm towel or blanket a few minutes ahead of time. When handling a child with high muscle tone, use a firm, gentle grasp. You want to maximize the surface area you are touching with your hand to decrease the risk of bruising and other injury. If the child is large enough, that means using your whole hand, the palms plus the fingers. If the child is smaller, use as much of your hand as you can. Use the pads, not the tips of your fingers, whenever possible. Use gentle but firm touch. Light touch can make muscles tense up. Think of how you react when you are tickled. Always use smooth, slow movements to help keep the child's muscles as relaxed as possible. Never pull on a limb or try to move it further than it wants to go. Children may have joint contractures or joints that will not bend or straighten all the way. Also, osteoporosis or fragile bones which fracture or break very easily are very common in children with high muscle tone. Remember that strength and high muscle tone are not the same thing. A child with high muscle tone is not choosing to resist you or fighting you on purpose. If you feel a child resisting, stop what you're doing, reassess the environment, and readjust the child's position. Proper positioning is your best friend when working with a child with high muscle tone. Whether lying down, sitting in a wheelchair, or supported in some other device, how a child is positioned makes a huge difference to muscle tone. Good positioning is the foundation of function, and stability is the cornerstone of good positioning. Imagine climbing a tree or a ladder when you suddenly lose your footing, or riding a bicycle and the road gets unexpectedly bumpy. What would your body feel like? What would your arms do? Chances are your muscles would tense up and you'd hang on tightly with your hands. A child who feels unstable will not be able to use his or her arms or pay attention to things around him or her as well as a child who is stable. For a child with high muscle tone, being unstable will also increase muscle tone. Jade, who has high muscle tone with higher muscle tone on her right side than her left, is going to demonstrate the importance of stability for us. Here, in her high chair, her body is completely well supported, and you can see how she's able to use both her arms with relative ease. Here, in her cube chair, her feet are still on the ground, and the back and one side of the cube chair are against her body, but she's not quite as well supported as she was in the high chair. You can see she's getting a bit more tone in her right arm and is leaning on that right arm for some added stability. But she's still able to play with her left hand and even her right with a little help. Here, sitting in this little chair, her feet are not supported at all, and she is needing to use both her arms to help stabilize herself, making it almost impossible for her to play, even with her left hand. Whether a child with high muscle tone is lying down, sitting, or in another piece of equipment, it is important that the child gets enough support to feel secure and stable, which allows muscles to relax and frees up the child's arms and concentration to play. This section contains practical techniques for positioning a child with high muscle tone in a chair or other seat and in bed. Remember, children who can't move independently need to be repositioned regularly for comfort and to prevent pressure sores. When positioning a child with high muscle tone, you generally want to get the hips and knees bent or flexed, the head in neutral or slightly flexed forward, and the arms in a position that allows the hands to come together in the center of the body. You may hear a therapist refer to this as flexed midline positioning. This positioning is important because children and teens with spastic high muscle tone tend to have higher tone in the muscles that arch the back and straighten the legs. When these muscles get very tense at the same time, it causes an extensor pattern or extensor posturing. See how Karis's neck extends, then her back arches, and her legs push down hard against the pillow? Children and teens with high muscle tone, like Karis, need a lot of help to get their bodies into flexed or forward-bending positions and strong external supports to keep them well-positioned. To explain why external supports are so important, Karis is going to show us what happens when that support is taken away. Can you see that since the therapist undid the chest straps, Karis's body is straining against her seatbelt? Notice that the therapist leaves the seatbelt on as she prepares the lift and gets the sling in place. She waits until the moment that the lift is in position to raise Karis up off her seat and then undoes the seatbelt. Watch what happens. See that? It took just a few seconds for Karis's body to go into that extensor posturing. So what is required for proper positioning in a wheelchair or supportive seat? First, the child needs a stable surface to sit on. Move straps and anything else out of the way and check the seat and back for lumps or uneven spots. Do up the seat or lap belt as soon as the child is in the chair. Remember what happened when Karis's seatbelt got undone? A well-positioned, snug lap belt or groin strap must be used to keep the child's hips bent and in the right place, as well as for safety. The seat belt should feel snug. If it seems like the seat belt is too tight, chances are the child's hips aren't all the way back in the chair. Make sure the hips are all the way back and then do the seat belt up again. Once the seat belt is done up, double-check that the child is sitting evenly or symmetrically with both hips all the way back in the chair. Once the hips are even and the seatbelt is secured, look up. Is the trunk even or symmetrical? The child should not be leaning to one side. Do up any chest straps and make sure the lateral or trunk supports are in place. If the child does not have a custom-fitted chair, you may need to provide support with rolled-up blankets or stuffed animals to keep the child from leaning to one side. Now, look down. Both feet should easily reach the footrests. Firm support under the feet makes the body feel more secure. The child's wheelchair is likely adjusted to fit when the child has shoes on, so make sure the shoes are on. Shoes also help keep the feet and ankles in a good position. If the child's feet do not reach the footrests, place a folded towel or other support under the feet until the chair can be adjusted. Are the child's hips, knees, and ankles at right angles? This is a good general rule to follow, but might vary between children depending on any joint contractures or other individual differences. Is there enough head support? Some children just need a rest behind their heads. Others need a headrest that also provides some side support. Has a solid table surface or armrests been provided? Having a solid place to rest your arms adds to your overall feeling of stability. Is the child as upright as he or she can be while still having good head control? Is the head in a neutral position or the chin slightly tucked down? This is especially important if you're going to be feeding the child. As the therapist was positioning Karis in the chair, she kept her movements slow and controlled and made sure Karis knew what she was about to do as she was working. She also got Karis to help by reminding her chin to chest when Karis was pushing back into an extensor posture. These principles of good positioning apply to whatever piece of equipment the child is being seated in. If you're unable to position the child well in the equipment you are using, please talk to the child's therapist. Do not leave a child unsupervised if you have any concerns about the safety of the seating arrangement, and never leave any child unsupervised in a wheelchair without a seatbelt securely fastened. Next, let's look at positioning children lying down. You want to place the child in a flexed midline position, the kind of position that looks comfortable or natural, and that a child who can move herself independently might choose, as Jade does here. Hips and knees at least partially bent, neck straight or slightly forward, not extended back, and shoulders forward enough that the hands can come together. When positioning children with high muscle tone, who need your help to move, you are simply aiming to recreate these positions and to provide enough physical support to keep them in the positions you place them in. Let's start with positioning in side lying. Here, Karis is demonstrating her custom-made sleeping support, which allows her to stay in a comfortable, partially flexed position on her side at night. It provides all the essential elements of good support in side lying. There is a firm support across her front that encourages the muscles at the front of her body to help her bend forward. There's a support at her back to keep her from rolling back. Her hips and knees are in a flexed or bent position. And there is a support between her legs which helps keep the top leg from dragging down, which is hard on the hips and back. Many of the children you work with, especially in an acute care inpatient setting, will not have a support like this, but you can use the same principles with pillows, bolsters, and other supports. Before you start, make sure that you have supports within reaching distance. These supports could be pillows, stuffed animals, wedges, bolsters, or rolled towels or blankets. Roll the child to his or her side, moving slowly and evenly. If the child can roll on her own, be sure to get her to help. Place a bolster or other support against the child's back. Place a support between the legs. Gently pull the bottom shoulder blade forward so the child is not lying on the bony point of the shoulder. Place a pillow or large stuffed toy against the child's chest. Rest the child's top arm over the pillow or toy. This position is called side lying or full side lying. Another option is partial side lying, also called banked positioning. To position a child in partial side lying, you follow all the same steps, placing a wedge or pillows behind the back. Once this is in position, allow the child to roll back onto the support. Then, if necessary, readjust the child's head position so that the neck is straight or the chin is slightly tucked towards the chest, not extended back. You may choose to place a pillow under the child's head in either full or partial side lying, depending on the child's preference. When positioning a child on his or her back, you also want to position inflection or forward bending at key points, just as you did in side lying. This will help break up any extensor posturing. Bend the child's hips, moving the legs one at a time. Move each leg slowly and steadily. You may get a lot of resistance at first, and then suddenly it will move much more easily, as happens here. This is another reason it's important to always move slowly and give your full attention to what you're doing. Once the hips are bent, place a pillow or other support under the child's knees. Flex or bend the neck forward and put a pillow or a folded blanket under the child's head. The order doesn't matter. You may choose to put a pillow under the head before you position the hips and knees. If you are going to be doing something with a child's arms, such as drawing blood or range of motion exercises, support the shoulders and arms in a slightly flexed position. Here, the therapist is able to support the arm with her hands. If you are starting an IV or drawing blood, place a support under the upper arm near the shoulders as well as under the rest of the arm. If any part of the body is not well supported, the child's muscle tone will be higher than it needs to be as the body tries to find stability. All children will have their own likes and dislikes. If you're working with a child for the first time or having difficulty positioning a child, speak to that child's parents or primary caregivers, as they will know the child's positioning and movement plan and preferences best. If the positioning plan or equipment needs to be reassessed, speak to the child's therapist. And remember, children who cannot move independently need to be placed in different positions regularly. Children with high muscle tone often have a stretching program for certain muscles. These stretches are important to keep these muscles from becoming shortened. Before doing the stretches, remember the principles of handling a child with high muscle tone. Check out the environment and make sure the child is comfortable in a well-supported position and warm enough. Your hands should be placed on either side of the joint being stretched. Only one joint at a time should be moved. Keep your hands close to the joint. Here, the therapist is bending Dale's hip. One hand is on the thigh, the other hand is hard to see, but it's just above his hip. Also, notice that she's using her whole hand with her fingers together to help spread the pressure over a larger area and prevent bruising. Keep all of your movements slow and controlled. Keep a gentle but firm grasp on the child throughout. Notice how the therapist keeps her hands firmly and comfortably on Dale as she moves from stretching his hip to his knee. Once you have a joint in the stretch position, hold the stretch for 20 to 30 seconds, or as long as the child's therapist has recommended. Holding the stretch is important. Only move the limb as far as it will go. Never force a limb to go farther than it wants to. Pay attention to what you feel with your hands and to how the child is reacting. This therapist talks to Dale as he tries to help and keeps her eyes on his face, only looking away to glance at the clock so she knows how long to hold the stretch. Improper technique or too much force while stretching can lead to injuries such as dislocated joints, pulled or torn muscles, bruising, and broken bones. However, not doing stretches can lead to contractures and other long-term problems, so it is important that these stretches be done, but safely. Be sure you know the specific stretches to be done and follow the directions of the child's physiotherapist or occupational therapist. In hospital, these are usually posted at the bedside. If you do not feel confident that you can do the stretches safely, please contact the child's therapist before doing them. Finally, please note that these instructions have been for stretches. Range of motion exercises are similar but different. Please watch the low muscle tone section of the video for range of motion instructions. When dressing a child or teen with high muscle tone, always get the child to help as much as possible. There is less risk of injury when the child is actively participating. Move the child's arms and legs in the same way that she would move them if she was able to dress herself. If the child has higher muscle tone on one side of his or her body, dress the higher tone side first. When undressing, undress the side with the higher muscle tone last. Tell the child what you are doing as you go, so the child is less likely to startle, causing an increase in muscle tone. If the child is small enough, dress her in a sitting position, either in your lap or on a small bench or chair. Because her hips and knees are bent in a sitting position, her extensor tone may be decreased, which will help her arms and legs to move more easily. When dressing a child in bed, especially if the child has significantly high muscle tone, you may find it easiest to start by positioning the child inside lying in a flexed position to decrease extensor tone. Choose clothes that are easy to get on and off. Sometimes finding the right clothes is a matter of trial and error. Here, we tried a new shirt on Dale. We thought it would go on easily because it unbuttons down the front, but because it isn't stretchy and Dale has very little movement in his shoulders, it was not possible to safely dress him in it. Even though the shirt's not working, notice that Dale's nurse does not try to force his shoulders or elbows to bend more. Never pull on a limb, and don't force a limb into a position that it is resisting. If you are not able to get the clothes on without forcing or pulling, choose a different piece of clothing. Dale's nurse switched to a shirt that she knew fit him easily, and she was able to finish dressing him without any difficulty. For children with limited movement, clothes that are easy to get on and off are important. Oversized tops, made of more stretchy material and that do up the front, and pants with elastic waists tend to work best. Here is a t-shirt that was modified for Dale. The snaps up the left side allow it to be placed over his right arm and over his head, and then snapped up on the left, eliminating the risks to his stiff shoulders. When dressing a child in pants or shorts or applying a diaper, roll the child being dressed from side to side to get the pants or diaper under the child without stressing his joints. Rolling the child side to side and moving one leg at a time will help prevent injury and avoid triggering an extensor reaction. Finally, never lift a child or a baby up by the heels. When moving any child with high muscle tone, remember that how you touch and handle the child and factors in the environment, such as unexpected noises and the temperature of the room, will affect the child's muscle tone. It can be stressful to be lifted or carried. Being in an unstable position, sudden movements and noises, and simply feeling scared can all lead to increased muscle tone and an increase in involuntary movements, which increase the risk of injury. It's important to have a plan. Know how you are going to do the lift or transfer before you start and tell the child what you're going to be doing in a calm, friendly voice. If the child does not know you well, be sure to tell him or her who you are. No one feels comfortable being picked up or moved around by an anonymous stranger. Move calmly and slowly. Have the child help as much as he or she can. Remember that the child's bones may be extra fragile. Always be sure that you know where the child's arms and legs are, that all straps are undone, and that the child's head is well supported before you begin the move. Ensure a clear path to where you are moving the child. Watch for and move out of your way seat belts, foot straps, toys, or other obstacles that might lead to an accident. To safely move or transfer older children and teens, you will require a mechanical lift, more than one caregiver, another transfer device such as a slider, or a combination of these. You will use the techniques and good body mechanics you've been taught elsewhere, but a few adjustments will be needed to avoid triggering high muscle tone. For example, quickly tucking a sling or slider directly under a child's back can be enough to trigger extensor posturing. Instead, the therapist places the sling by rolling the child side to side. Here, the therapist rolls Karis onto her side first, spreads a sling on the bed, then simply rolls Karis onto her back and partway onto her other side to pull it the rest of the way through. By doing most of the sling placement with Karis on her side, the therapist minimizes and avoids triggering Karis's extensor posturing by not pushing directly under her back. The therapist also moves calmly and slowly and avoids fast, rough movements. Whether simply moving a child in bed or using a mechanical lift, remember that sudden movements and loud noises can cause extensor posturing. Try to minimize loud noises as you prepare the equipment. Move in a steady, calm way and make sure you let the child know what you're going to be doing. When using a mechanical lift, have everything planned out in advance so the child is up in the air for as short a time as possible and so you are able to stay calm and relaxed. Have the child well positioned before you start the transfer. Provide support to the child's head as it lifts off the bed and keep the neck straight or bent just slightly forward if you can. If the child has a very strong extensor pattern, that may not be possible. Here, the therapist is providing support to Karis's head at first, but Karis begins to push back strongly against her hand. Because the therapist knows that her hand is contributing to this extensor reaction, she removes it. Once the transfer is completed, you must remove the sling from under the child to prevent pressure sores. Once the sling is removed, check that the child is still well positioned in the chair. Some children with high muscle tone will be small enough for you to lift and carry on your own without the use of special equipment. When carrying a child with high muscle tone, choose a position in which the child's hips and knees are bent to around a 90-degree angle. Here, Jade and her dad are demonstrating a front carry position and a side carry position. Both of these positions naturally encourage bent hips and knees. Because he knows she can, Jade's dad is letting her hold her head up on her own. Notice, though, that he keeps one hand on her back and is ready to provide more support if she moves unexpectedly or loses her head control. If the child you are lifting or carrying needs head support, place one arm or hand at the base of the skull. If you do not know the child well, assume he or she needs full head support. When lifting Dale, his nurse supports his head and shoulders with one arm, and the other arm supports him at his hips and upper thighs. Because Dale's muscle tone is so high and rigid, his body stays pretty straight. With most children, it's possible to keep their hips and knees more bent or flexed than this. However straight or flexed the child's body is, be sure to keep the child's head in midline, that is facing straight, and the arms and legs close to the body. If you have any questions about lifting or moving children you are working with, please consult the child's movement plan, ask the child's parents or other primary caregivers, or speak with the child's therapist. This is the end of the specific high muscle tone section. Please note that three important care activities, bathing, putting on splints and braces, and feeding, are covered at the end of the video in a joint high and low muscle tone section.